are lucky to have leaders like Natalie in our community, and having conversations like that is really, really impactful. I'm so grateful to be with you all today. It fills my heart to see so many familiar faces in the room. I walked in this morning and saw so many friends. And I challenge you to take a look around you, and you'll see a face of someone who wants you to succeed. And I can tell you that it is really incredible to be in a space where people are cheering and rooting for each other. That is the kind of community I want to live in and be part of building. I specifically want to shout out two people who helped me prepare to speak with you today. My friends, Terry Grateful Liggins and Laura Smith Hill. I'm so incredibly grateful for the two of you. Today, I am incredibly honored to share a bit of my own journey with you and how we can all use design thinking to improve our lives. If we don't know each other, my name is Sara Lum. I work at a nonprofit called Startup Sioux Falls. At Startup Sioux Falls, we empower founders to start and grow businesses and ignite innovation in our community. Working with founders is incredibly inspiring. Anybody can have an idea, but it takes guts and grit to bring an idea to reality. As a licensed architect, I love bringing ideas to reality, and I am an expert at a process called design thinking. I left my career as an architect 5 years ago, but design thinking is part of who I am and how I think. There's a common misconception that design is reserved for those considered creative, but design is a process, not a product. Everyone is creative, and everyone can learn to think more like a designer and become more empathetic and curious in solving problems. We have all been asked the question, what do you want to be when you grow up? Until I was 8 years old, I wanted to be a wide receiver for the Minnesota Vikings. Yeah, who didn't want to be Chris Carter in 1995? Some of you weren't born. But the problem with this question is that it presumes that our personal and professional lives should have a destination. We become obsessed with pursuing an idea of what we want to be instead of the kind of person we want to become. We become ambitious about pursuing success as defined by our families, our peers, and the culture around us. Without testing the destinations we idealize in our minds, we cannot know if the life we are designing is a life we actually want to live. In entrepreneurship, this would be like designing a product or service without testing if there's a market of people willing to buy it. Eventually, I reached the age where wanting to be a wide receiver for the Vikings was no longer acceptable. I was artistic and good at math, so at 14 years old, I decided I would become an architect. Except for the occasional emotional phone call to friends or family after late nights in the design studio, I never looked back. Like a good Midwesterner, I kept plowing toward the goal. My first professional job after grad school was a one-year fellowship at a nonprofit design startup in Omaha. Our work promoted design conversations that impacted the community and promoted change. We hosted a series of really interesting things. We hosted an international design competition and installed massive art banners on abandoned grain silos along I-80. And then we hosted a 500-person event on a bridge overlooking those art banners, featuring local food stations designed by local designers and chefs. We designed and fabricated a series of parklets to support pedestrian and business activity along a busy street. And we mapped the land use changes of one of the fastest growing counties in the country and interviewed citizens about the changing landscape of their community. This is where the seed of my love for community and economic development was planted. After the fellowship, I moved back to my home state of South Dakota to be a founding faculty member of the Department of Architecture at South Dakota State University. It was the first new architecture school on the Great Plains in over 100 years. We were a startup operating within an established institution. I loved teaching design, mentoring students, and research. However, teaching design also required a lot of talking, which wasn't a great fit for me, even though I'm on this stage today. At this point, I was 10 years in on the journey, and I decided it was time to finish what I started by working for a traditional practice and completing the licensure process. I worked on some incredible projects and gained valuable experience. But I now know I was doing it because I wasn't ready to give up on the sunk costs I had already invested. 12 years after high school, after 7 years of school, $60,000 in student loans, over 3,000 experience hours, and passing 7 exams, I was very proud to call myself an architect. However, once I reached the goal and gave myself time and space to sit with my feelings, it was clear that what I had been relentlessly pursuing was not what I wanted after all. I learned a very important lesson. Invest in a design for your life that you want, not one driven by your insecurities or by someone else or society. Are you currently designing a life that you want? Ironically, to solve this problem, I turned to the greatest gift that architecture ever gave me, design thinking. Design thinking is a tool used to innovate products and services in the world around us. It is also a tool we can use to improve our lives. The design thinking process has 5 stages. The first stage, empathize, is about understanding the users you are designing for through research and engagement. What are their values? What do they like and dislike? How do they spend their time? When applying design thinking to our lives, this means understanding ourselves and acknowledging and accepting where we are. It doesn't matter how old you are not too young, you're not too old. It doesn't matter what job you have or think you should have. It doesn't matter where you're from or where you think you're going. This is possibly the most difficult part of the process. We must accept where we are before we can move forward. My own story is evidence of how difficult this can be. So we are going to do an exercise. I want everyone to take out a piece of paper and a pen. I'm assuming you brought something with you today. Now, imagine a car dashboard that displays all the vital signs of your car. Mine told me this morning I need to get an oil change. And we're going to use this exercise, but apply it to our life. So we're going to reflect and assess our personal dashboard in 4 essential areas of our lives: health, work, play, and love. You're going to have 45 seconds to reflect on your dashboard and rate these areas on a scale from empty to full. Don't overthink it. All right, your time starts now. If you have time, you can write down what full looks like in those different areas for you. All right, you can finish up your last thoughts. This dashboard is not a judgment, but it's a tool. This is a snapshot that you can use to identify what the authors of the book Designing Your Life call life design problems. If there are a couple areas that you're like, I'm not very full in that area, you might be able to identify a problem that you can think about solving using design thinking. After empathize, the next phase of the design thinking process is define. For designers, defining the problem is just as important as solving the problem. One way we can clearly identify problems in our own lives is having a clear understanding of our values. This gives our ambition purpose and direction. For much of my own life, I was driving without a clear direction, pursuing success without truly knowing what I was pursuing or why. One of the ways I personally have historically numbed my own feelings of insecurity and fear of self-acceptance is overwork, attempting to prove my value and worth through work and achievement. Overwork eventually turns me into an empty shell that is not present with myself, the people around me, or most importantly, my friends and family. Allowing our insecurities to drive our ambition and our path is a clear path towards emptiness. What insecurities and shame are you letting drive your life? So let's dive into this idea a little bit further with two final exercises. Take out that paper again, and in the center of the paper, draw a line. And on the left side of the paper, I want you to write work. And on the right side of the paper, I want you to write life. I got my directions right, I think. So this exercise explores the core ideas that drive you in your work and in your life. Take a moment to think about and answer one of the following questions. And you're going to do this on the left side of the page. What defines good or worthwhile work? What do money and relationships have to do with work? Why do you work? Ultimately, what does work mean to you? I'm going to give you 45 seconds to do this, starting now. I encourage you to be as honest as possible as you do this. There are no right or wrong answers. All right. Finish your thought, and then we're going to move on to the right side. Now let's transition from work to life. This life encompasses your fundamental beliefs about the world and how it operates. Think about one or more of the following questions as you do this. What role do experiences, failure, and success have in your life? What does it mean to live a good life? How do relationships factor into it? Ultimately, what gives your life meaning? All right, you're going to have another 45 seconds to do this, and then we'll come back. I encourage you to spend some more time with this exercise afterwards. It's pretty quick to establish your life and work values in 45 seconds. All right, let's come back and now step back and look at both side by side. And think about, do they resonate with one another? Are there any conflicts between your work and your life view? If you notice any misalignments, this could be an area where you might have a problem worth solving. Your worldview and your life view are your compass for designing your life. When our worldview and life view are in alignment, our lives have purpose and direction. After define, the next step in the process is ideate. Ideating involves challenging our assumptions and generating as many ideas as possible. Within each of us, there are several possible lives worth living. We each contain multitudes. We may not be able to live out each of our possible realities, but with some empathy and curiosity, we can build lives that are more authentic to who we are. As we get old and older, and the limitless possibilities of youth fade, it can feel like we are bound by more and more constraints and responsibilities. But every design challenge has constraints. Designers and leaders see constraints as opportunities for creativity. I believe that problems with the most constraints often have the most potential for innovation. Ideation tools such as mind mapping and odyssey planning can help us expand our imaginations about what is possible for our lives. We don't have time to explore these exercises today, but I want to walk you through the steps and share a hypothetical example from my own life. Odyssey planning is a fantastic way to stimulate imaginative thinking about the future and suggest actionable steps you can take towards building a future. So Odyssey planning involves detailing three completely different versions of the next 5 years of your life. Each path should reflect different approaches toward your work and life view. Again, your work and life view can serve as a compass. So version one of your Odyssey plan would be the next 5 years of the path you are currently on. Version two of your Odyssey plan would be the next 5 years if the path that you're currently on would cease to exist. And version three is the version of your life you would live if money were no object. So this is an example of a fantasy Odyssey plan of my own, where I moved to Paris and I live a quiet and creative life, working remotely, writing in cafes, and riding a scooter. Yes, you can laugh at that. It's a little obnoxious. If this exercise interests you, this template and many other tools are available for free on designingyour.life. It's really fun. I also encourage you, another really fun part of Odyssey planning is creating mood boards and visuals inspired by each plan. If you have been wanting to experiment with AI, exploring your Odyssey plans is a great excuse. I had a little bit of fun with this. So the final two steps of design thinking, prototyping and testing, are incredibly important. Prototyping and testing alternatives allow us to test ideas before making big decisions. A few examples of prototyping include having a conversation with someone who's in a role or living their life in a way that you're interested in. Or it could be conducting a mini test. If you want to be a chef, don't quit your job and go become a chef. Maybe volunteer at a restaurant for a little bit to see if it's really something you'd want to do. Most positive change in our lives doesn't require drastic risk-taking. Once you make a choice, it doesn't mean you have to choose it forever. Our lives are a process, not a destination. In all of this, building a supportive community is critical. Surround yourself with people who are willing to invest in the design of your life, and do the same for them. Why are we all here today if not to support each other? As leaders, what if we thought more like designers and embraced our personal and professional journeys with more curiosity, empathy, and collaboration? How could that change our lives and our community? I don't want to know what you want to be when you grow up. I want to know what your work means to you and what gives your life meaning. If we do this for ourselves and the next generation, we will be much more prepared to face the complex challenges of our future. A world and economy that is going to require creativity and critical thinking. Design of products, buildings, our lives is a process. The best visions are created in versions. I hope you are inspired to work on your vision for the next version of you. It is time to start designing. My name is Sara Lum. Thank you for allowing me to share a piece of myself with you today. I invite you to connect with me. I'd love to support you in your journey to design your life. Thank you.